We know that we have a challenge at the moment in healthcare in the UK, and I think in many other countries as well. And that's that healthcare is seen as the point of call for problems. But as a result of this, currently we find that between a third and a half of all visits to doctors are actually for non-medical reasons. They're for broader issues, for example, feeling lonely or socially isolated, low-level mental health problems, or other issues in people's lives that might well be translating into health issues, but actually at their root cause are not medical. So because of this, there's this recognised resource drain that's occurring and this pressure that's being put on health services. And so there's been interest in the last few years on something called social prescribing. The idea that if somebody comes to their doctor with a problem that actually might not be getting the right solution, could they be being referred on to other services that might be able to provide better support? Now, this has a couple of benefits. First of all, it might provide better support for the patients themselves. People who keep going back to their doctor and not being able to find a solution might become frustrated, and it also might lead them to feel that they're not being considered as a whole person in their own right. But equally, it can also reduce pressure for doctors. Doctors have very short consultation times with each patient, and also the cost of these unnecessary visits in some analyses is thought to be equivalent of the salaries of nearly 4,000 doctors every year. So the way that social prescribing works is that if somebody goes to the doctor and the doctor thinks, well, what you've come to me with isn't something that I can solve in a medical way, the doctor can write a prescription to this patient to go and see somebody called a link worker or navigator. The link worker's role is to know all of the activities that exist in the local community. For example, gardening clubs, arts classes, book groups, other types of social activities, choirs. And the idea of this link worker is to spend much more time with the patient, to actually be able to talk to them properly, to find out what it is that their needs are. Are these needs that actually could be supported by some kind of community social activity? And if so, what kind of activity is the person going to want to go to? What's actually going to meet their needs and also their enjoyment? Now, in some cases, it might be the case that this link worker is merely able to refer somebody onto an existing programme. In other cases, they might need a slightly closer contact. They might need to actually pass them over to an individual who's going to help them be introduced to a new activity. They might be checking up on them on a more regular basis. Or for some, it could be there's a really specific activity that's probably going to have more benefit than others, and therefore there's a more targeted prescription to that activity. So to give an example of some of the programmes that exist, there's a wonderful programme called Green Gym, which is all about helping conservation volunteering to be something that people can use for their own health and well-being. So people take part in activities like fixing fences, helping with the cleaning of ponds, helping with the development of new gardens and conservation areas. And through the process of this, they're meeting more people in the community, and they're also doing something that could benefit their mental health. Now, Green Gym has worked in partnership with a charity called Mind, which is a mental health charity. So it's a very well-informed programme in that it actually understands the needs of many of the people who might be coming onto it. Another example is called Arts and Minds. This is run around the Cambridgeshire area, and this is arts programmes for people to help their mental health. And again, this is very carefully constructed. All the sessions have artists and also have counsellors in the room. So they've got this dual support, but there's the recognition that the arts classes might be able to offer something that could really help this person in their mental health. So what are these things that could actually be helped by these activities? What are these magical ingredients? The idea behind Arts on Prescription is that arts activities are what we call multimodal activities. They combine multiple different factors that we know are beneficial for health. For example, they give a chance for emotional expression. They might be stress reducing for their calming or relaxing nature. They might provide social support. They might introduce people to new people so they feel less lonely in their areas. They might be providing cognitive stimulation. They might be helping with skills development so people actually learn new skills, have got new employability options as well. They might be helping with broader social capital and social cohesion within communities. So all of these different factors together can start to add up to have an effect on health. What's particularly good about arts and creative activities in providing all of these different components is that they've got an inherent motivation to engage. People often want to do these as fun hobbies as well. So this can actually be an added incentive for people to actually take part and regularly go to these sessions. So let's consider a patient who actually went through this. I met this guy called Russell a few years ago, and Russell said that he'd initially been going to his doctor because he suffered a very serious stroke. And following the stroke, he actually developed depression. He wasn't able to work or provide for his family. And he said this was really difficult for him to cope with. And so because of this, he was feeling very low in self-esteem. He had a number of other symptoms that started to develop, for example, difficulty in sleeping. So as a result, he was going back to the doctor trying to get solutions to this. And he was offered a number of medical solutions, medication, things to help with sleep, with anxiety. But these really weren't solving what his issues were. And he said eventually his doctor offered him a program called Artlift. And initially he said he was very reticent. He didn't want to go along. He thought it was going to be a room full of people hugging each other. But he said he went along to the first session just to see. And he was actually amazed. He really enjoyed it. He really enjoyed painting, something he hadn't really done before. So he started going back, and actually over a period of weeks, he started to see benefits. He was no longer needing help with his sleep. He was with his doctor, he was gradually able to reduce the medication that he was on till he was off it completely. He actually started to develop new skills, a real sense of pride and achievements. In fact, he discovered a real talent for painting and actually started being commissioned to do exhibitions of his work. He's also now running his own sessions in the community for other people who've had similar mental health problems or physical challenges, and actually helping them to learn the same skills he has, to take part in the same kinds of programs that he was referred to. So it's been this wonderful virtuous cycle back to him actually now supporting exactly the same type of people that he was a few years ago. So a natural question for all of this is, well, where does the money come from? So a number of these Arts on Prescription programs are actually paid for by arts organisations or philanthropists, charities or lottery funds. Some of them actually though are being paid for by the healthcare system in the UK. And what's being found is that some areas of the healthcare sector are quite keen to pay because these programmes have actually been shown to reduce some of the costs for healthcare. For example, it's been found that for every pound that gets spent on link workers, up to £4 is being saved. In fact, possibly somewhere between £4 and £11 from some studies is being saved in terms of reductions in unnecessary medication prescriptions or reductions in the number of visits to doctors. And as well as this, we're also seeing wider benefits for the health sector. For example, we know that there can be very long waiting lists for people to get psychological therapies, whereas in fact, Arts and Minds, the programme I mentioned in Cambridgeshire, that can refer people in 48 hours. And we also find that there are other areas of repeat visits that can be supported. And there was a pilot project that ran in Croydon where they particularly looked at admissions to hospital and use of other healthcare services, and found a 20% reduction in this for people who'd taken part in arts programmes on prescription. As we're looking forwards to what's happening next, we can already see that there are hundreds of general practices, doctor surgeries around the UK that are already taking part in arts on prescription and also the broader scheme of social prescribing. But we're actually starting to see that there are some that are getting incredibly committed. For example, in Tower Hamlets, they have over 90% of their GP practices are engaged in this, and 98% of the doctors, the GPs who prescribe, are reporting benefits for their patients. So partly in light of this, we've had announcements from NHS England that they're now going to be rolling out wider support for social prescribing. And this includes funding 1,000 new link workers to work at doctor surgeries around the UK to be able to refer people through to these programmes to help with their health. So overall, I think what's particularly promising about Arts on Prescription isn't just about the benefits that we're getting in terms of helping the health sector, but it's also about the individual benefits that we're seeing here. That for patients who before might have been feeling that they weren't having all of their needs met, we've now got the option that this can be added in as another option within their treatments. And also what this provides is looking at the person as a whole person, considering every aspect of their lives that might require support. And I think this is very comforting to patients because it can feel like they're actually being really listened to and that people are actually really keen to help them. And it also provides a very nice joined up working between health sector, social sector, and also the arts, voluntary and community sectors as well. And this, I think, is perhaps a way we should be considering healthcare more in terms of not just seeing it as the responsibility of the health sector, but as seeing it as something that multiple other bodies can all support in bringing their own skills, their expertise, their programmes together to make sure that we've got multiple options to help the multiple different aspects of people's health.